d4, knight f6, c4, g6, knight f3, bishop g7, g3, short castle, bishop g2, d6, short castle, knight c6, knight c3, a6. Now we approached to the main line, Yugoslavian variation, which starts with d5. This is very solid, very complex, very strategic. But according to the recent games, according to the recent analysis, white, black is, it's okay here. And all this, all type of sacrifices we know from very long time, like bishop h6, rook takes b2, they really work. I mean, it's confirmed. So let's have a look how it's going move by move. Knight a5, knight d2, c5. Now, black have to know two setups for white here. One is rook b1, another queen c2. First, in this chapter, we will study exclusively rook b1, and then the next one with queen on c2. So after rook b1, it's a little bit strange reaction for us, but since you already saw this in the previous chapters, when we tried to provoke somebody to close this bishop on g2, so some pawn or f3 or e4 to come and shorten its diagonal. So in this case, we shorten by bishop f5, attacking the rook, so we're forcing him practically to play e4. We have to go back bishop d7, so he kind of gave a tempo, but as we know, the pawns don't move back, so in many cases, this pawn on e4 is even on black's favor. So because also, beside the fact that he closed this diagonal, in some variations after b3, bishop b2, they had the plans to jump with knight to e4. Now the square from this two both knights, it's taking away, as well as from the bishop. So this is like theoretical part. Let's see practically how it works. Queen e2 here. It's like to stop b5, but in this case we can open the second front. e6, a3, ed5. cd5, queen c7, it's directed against b4, now this the knight on c3 will be hanging after cb4, so small prophylactical, b3, b5, knight d1, this was the game of Hulak against Fedorov, and then Fedorov should continue with c4, because after bc4 he would have a very strong move, rook c8 attacking on c4, because taking on b5 is not possible. Well, that's queen e2, it's a weird move. Of course, after bishop d7, the most natural way for him is to play bishop b3, and this is the main plan for white, to put the bishop to b2. e5, that's the very consecutive play by black. There is no point to play, ask him for e4, and then let him prepare peacefully e5. Of course, we have to fight for the center, and with e5 we close the position. So after e5 he has plenty of moves. Bishop b2, queen c2. Let's try it with queen c2 first. If queen c2, then b5. If bishop b2, bishop h6, we will transpose to the main line. It's more important to know what to do after cb5, ab5, and b4. This is very typical reaction. That's one of the points to not put the bishop to b2 and the rook to b1 to have this b4 move. But always here we have enough counterplay on the c-file, using the pressure on the c-file as well as the square c4 for the knight. Queen c7, queen b2, queen c5, knight b5. Rook ab8, a4, rook fc8, with compensation on Hulak Fedorov. After b5, he might try here knight e2. This is a more tricky, more positional way. I mean, when I played Yugoslav variation with black myself, for example, against Peter Heine Nissen, he was using something similar, this knight e2, knight d2, bishop b2, bishop c3, queen d3, very like solid positional setup. So against this kind of steps, it's good to be fast with knight h5, followed by f5, for example. If he goes himself f4, then always we destroy this by playing e4, gf4 and f5. For us, what is important, it's not to keep these two pawns e4 and f4 alive. So if he cannot play e5 here, so then we will destroy his pawn structure. If he doesn't go f4, 15 after knight h5, then as I said, we will go f5 ourselves. Let's say bishop b2, we go f5, and now normally if he's a man, he has to take the challenge and play f4, because otherwise we will take advantage and we'll play f4 ourselves. So after f4, still more or less the same. We have to fight for the center. First queen 7, because he wanted to take on e5, so now we will take most probably with the piece on e5 for a while. It's protected, the e5. Rook b1, bringing the piece into the struggle. bc4, bc4, and now fe4. It's a little bit of a mess, looks like, but with accurate play, black controls everything. Yes. For example, fe5, bishop e5, bishop e5, queen e5. This is fine. I think that's perfectly fine. He can try to call this after bc3, bc4 to try to attack this knight on a5. There is was an attempt like this, and to sacrifice pawn, cbab, knight b7. Here he has one tempo for himself in order to create more pressure on e5 square. I mean, that makes sense, but no problem. We take on f4, knight f4, bishop c3, queen c3, knight f4, rook f4, fe4, rook e4, and queen g7. Thanks to this defense, rook f7, we are doing fine in this line. So, that was a little bit sharp, but we managed to hold with black. So that's about this subtle positional move, queen c2, b5, and knight e2. Same type of moves as knight e2, it's kind of knight d1 here. It's about the same approach. In this case, we might even play here already not knight h5, but bishop h6, because what he wanted is to go to e3, and if he goes to e3, we will take and we close completely the position after bishop e3 and b4. That was Aronian in Arkiv game. Of course, after it, after 12 e5, the main line for him is to play bishop b2. We go this obviously b5. But look at the position. It's very tight. I mean, we lost a tempo with bishop f5, bishop d7, but the center is closed. We have some pressure on c4. And let's say queen c2, bishop h6. Remember this move. It's a little bit strange that we take away the bishop from very important diagonal. But it's kind of provocation. The point is that his pieces are all on the queen side, first of all. So if something starts on the king side, we still have a little bit of advantage and piece advantage. This is first point. Second, this is very annoying. This bishop h6 works together very well with the knight on e5, making some serious pressure on c4. And later you will see, in the next chapter, you will see also a combination of this pressure together with rook b8 and some rook b2, rook takes b2. So let's see here, first of all, after bishop h6, he has several moves. On knight d1 already we can take on c4, and forcing him to take with the knight. Remember, this knight on a5, and actually general rule for the knight on a5, It's not the best square for the knight on the edge of the board. So the moment we have the chance to exchange it and to get rid of it, we should be happy and should take the chance. In this case, by forcing him to take with the knight, we say thank you, we take on c4, rook b8, and have a decent position, even slightly better. If he goes knight e2, then we do the same we change, and rook b8. I mean, in both cases, this bishop h6, one of the ideas for us is to exchange, it's not even to win the pawn, but even to exchange the knight a5 for the knight on d2. So the main line is after bishop h6 should be f4 to stop the activity of this bishop, e4. And now for a long time it was considered this knight e2, very strong move, etc., etc. Because here if gf4, it's not good enough. After knight h5, knight e2, rook b8. We created already serious threats. If queen c3, then simply bishop g7. I think if bishop c3, this is the most natural move. Then we can close position with b4, bishop b2, and now very strong move, bishop g4. So, I mean, the dynamics allows us to control the situation. That's why this knight e2, perhaps it's a really interesting move. But then, we take on c4. He's not obliged to take with the pawn, with the knight, he can take with the pawn. And now important positional, just from general culture point of view, this move f3. So do not allow him to create this pawn control on e5, which can support later for e4, e5. That can become dangerous already. For example, if knight f3, we have a very nice trick, knight takes e4 and bishop f5. If bishop takes f3, then as we said, we have this pressure on d2, so here is exactly the moment to take on d2 and to take on c4. This is perfectly good moment, so he has to take on f3 with the rook. Then we go on g4. Already the picture becomes more clear for us. We have the e5 square. Yes, he has some control over the diagonal, but he cannot really use it. Knight f4, knight e5, rook f2, and rook b8. Already it's clear that we succeeded in order to stop his play with e5. So practically what we have to remember about this line with rook on b1, then rook on b1 when he's avoiding queen c2 and these lines, it's to provoke e4. Go bishop d7 back, and then first we will go e5 after b3, and only after that we will go b5. On the king side, usually we would play with bishop h6. Sometimes when he is slow, we can even play knight h5 and f5 ourselves.